The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hello and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. With me today, it is my pleasure to welcome Dan Coats, Senior Senator, Republican from Indiana. Senator, welcome.
Yeah, thank you very much, Kevin.
Glad you could be here on your vacation from Washington. So,
well, it doesn't really fit the definition of vacation. It's a work period, and we're spending a lot of time getting across Indiana.
Exactly.
Listening to a lot of Hoosiers.
Well, and we can talk a little bit about what they're telling you about a few timely issues. Why don't we start with Syria, which is on everybody's mind, what to do about it or not to do about it. The Senate Foreign Relations Committee just voted narrowly, 10-7, mm-hmm. to give the president a fairly narrow authorization to take action in Syria.
Right.
Now, I know you put out a statement a few days ago that you hoped the president would in fact do that, because initially he said he wouldn't. He's now gone to Congress. What do you think Congress would and should do, and have you made up your mind where you stand?
Well, to answer that reverse order, I have not yet come to a conclusion as to what is in the best interests of our country going forward. And I am using this week, which I thought we would be called back to deal with this Syria issue, but we weren't. I'm using this week to get around Indiana and talk to as many people, held a forum this morning out here southwest Fort Wayne and talking to a number of different people across the state. Listening to what their thoughts are. I want to represent and know their thoughts on this whole thing. And I personally have several reservations. Now, obviously, we all want to do what is in the best interest of our country. But when you can't get a clear definition from the president in terms of just exactly what is he trying to do? Is he trying to make up for a mistake that, you know, this red line, and he feels like if he doesn't do something, people will have called his bluff. The confusing message of 2 years ago, we need to get rid of Bashar Assad, president of Syria, and now saying, no, we don't want to do anything that will influence his leaving.
Right, they're saying explicitly no regime change.
No regime change. Well, what are we trying to accomplish here? Are we just trying to, as the president said, shoot one across the bow? I mean, what does that mean? And what kind of message does that send? So I just think we're still looking for answers from the president on a number of specific issues. What is the goal? Does this mean Congress does not, and I will not support another armed conflict, putting American men and women in uniform
of course,
in the Middle
East
conflict.
They're saying that is not part of the authorization.
Well, yeah, they're saying that. But, you know, when you take military action, regardless of what it is, you can't, as Winston Churchill said, you better fasten your seatbelt for the hurricane to come because you cannot predict what's going to be next.
Right.
You have to weigh that in terms of not doing something. Now, neither one of those are good options because they can have negative consequences. But I'm trying to figure out what the policy is going forward relative to the whole Middle East, relative to all these conflicts. What is the U.S. role going to be? And given our more than a decade in Iraq and more than a decade in Afghanistan, we are not in a position to enter into or try to solve a problem in the Middle East, which is primarily a civil war. But we do have this element of terrorists, al-Qaeda, al-Nusra, and others interjecting themselves in it. And their war is against us as much as it is against the rulers right. in the Middle East.
Well,
so it's a complicated matter.
Don't you first have to define not only the threat to
yes.
us, but
yes.
then, as you mentioned, our national interest.
Exactly.
Do you think, from what you can tell now, the threat would justify the risk and is action in our national interest?
I have not come to that conclusion yet, and the president has not made that case yet, in my opinion. I, as you know, serve on the Intelligence Committee. I have access to a lot of classified information. But there still is some confusion just exactly who is this opposition, mm-hmm. what is it made up of, what is the role of Al-Qaeda in this opposition. So if we overturn the Assad regime through tilting it one way or another through submission of weapons or provision of weapons or through whatever military action we might take, are we going to end up with something worse or something equally bad as what we're facing now? And until we get clear picture of that, hopefully I'll have to get that before we vote on this thing, I'm still keeping my powder dry and how to go forward. Again, I want to do what's in the best interest of the United States. But if the policy doesn't make sense in terms of how to get there, we've got to clear it up before you can make that decision.
Well, what do you think you would have to hear from the president that he hasn't already said that would help you make up your mind one way or the other?
Well, a clear goal in terms of what our policy will be, not just in Syria, but toward everything that's happening in the Middle East. What is in our most strategic interest? Now, in my opinion, and I've been talking about this for several years, the real long-term threat to our national interest is Iran with nuclear capability.
Which is aligned with Syria.
Which is aligned with Syria, is supporting Syria. So that plays into this whole equation. What signal are we going to send to Iran relative to their pursuit of weapons of mass destruction? Because everyone acknowledges that once they get that possession, that's a game changer in the Middle East, and that's a game changer for the world.
A red line, you might say.
Well, you might say that because four consecutive presidents have said it is unacceptable and clearly not in the strategic interest of the United States to allow Iran to have that capability. And the threat to Israel, the arms race that might ensue, the threat to our allies in Europe, and the threat to ourselves over that, and the threat to the economy based on the oil situation, the
right.
shutdown. All of that is in our interest. And so that's really where I need to understand how what we do in Syria impacts that decision vis-a-vis Iran.
Well, right, and there are people who say it could flare up if we attack, you know, involving Israel, mm-hmm. would the Soviet Union get involved on behalf of Syria?
Right.
So there's a lot of ramifications right. that mm-hmm. need to be explored. The polls seem to indicate that the American people don't want to go in. What are you finding as you go around your state while you're home?
I'm finding that the vast majority of Hoosiers do not want us to get engaged in any way in any new Middle East conflict. They're referencing back to Iraq, they're referencing back to Afghanistan, but also what happened in Egypt, what happened in Libya, what they see happening throughout the Middle East, and basically saying, can we solve that problem? Should we get engaged any more than we've been engaged? And haven't we learned something from the frustration that we've had in terms of getting these states turned around and supportive of us? So today we see, 12 years later, a real disarray in Afghanistan. We see a lot of conflict going on within Iraq, and much more to come. And so you really have to ask that tough question, what more can we do?
Mm-hmm. Will the feelings of your constituents be the driving factor in what you ultimately decide, or will yeah. you base it more on, as you mentioned, the intelligence you receive yeah. and then what is in the national interest?
You know, Kevin, that's a very good question. I think to be an effective representative, you've got to know what your people are thinking, at least what the majority is thinking. And that has to be part of your decision making. But also, you have to have established, hopefully, the trust that they have in you in sending you to represent them, that you do have access to information that perhaps they don't have. And they want you to exercise your best judgment in light of sometimes choices that aren't black and white, aren't just all good or all bad, that are very murky and very complex, and this one is. And so in the end, I'm trying to put all that together, the best knowledge I can gain through intelligence sources, the best information I can get from the Democrat Party and the leadership there in terms of what the president really wants to do and what his goal is. And then weigh all this in light of what I ultimately think is in the best interest of the United States and a policy that promotes that and doesn't detract from that. and then make a decision, yes or no. Ultimately, it comes down to a yay or a nay.
Well, you can't blame the public, I don't think, for being a little confused, because a lot of the people arguing for involvement today were arguing against it in Iraq and vice versa. So
that's right.
There's a certain element of politics involved, which even depending on who you listen to, some people think is in play with the president bringing it to Congress now, that originally he was going to go alone. And now, does he really want your opinion, or is he looking somebody to share the blame if things go wrong?
Well, you know, there have been some tweets between some of his operatives, David Axelrod and others, that seem to indicate that, yeah, we got him right where we want him politically. Look, when you're talking about war, when you're talking about use of the military, when you're talking about the lives of young men and women, Americans in uniform, this decision shouldn't be made on politics. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't, you know, maybe you're miffed at the president and you want to teach him a lesson or discard his thinking or whatever. You've got to think about the consequences of what we're doing here. There's no harder vote than the vote to authorize the use of military force. Even way back early on when the first Desert Storm won, when it looked so clear that this is what we should do, it was one of the hardest votes I've ever cast.
And it should be.
Knowing that it might not go well. Fortunately, it did go well. The second invasion didn't go well. I wasn't in Congress at the time. A lot of measures pointed to the fact that we should do this, but you just can't always predict that. So this is what really brings you right down to the essence of being a representative and having to make a yay or a nay relative to people's lives.
Well, and ultimately, not to tell you how to do your job, but you have to vote your conscience, I would think.
You do.
Well, we could talk about that all half hour, but let's move on a little bit. The other pending crisis is yet again the potential shutdown of the federal government if Congress doesn't authorize some kind of additional spending bill. And some members of your party are saying perhaps we should use that as an opportunity to defund Obamacare.
Yeah.
You have said, wait a minute, not so fast. Mm. What do you think will and should happen? I know as a good conservative, you'd like to get a handle on the budget, but politically it's very difficult. What's the Dan Coats approach?
Well, look, I'm on the same page as every Republican in the United States Senate is, and I think almost every Republican in the House of Representatives. We think Obamacare is a disaster. We think it ought to be repealed. I think we have a responsibility to put forward our own proposal because we do have problems with healthcare expenses and healthcare costs and the impact on our economy. And a number of us, including me, have put forward other proposals as to if you don't have this, what should you have? Right now, we do not control government. We control the House of Representatives, but not the Senate and not the White House. And therefore, only one third of the government, and we do not have the votes to repeal this plan. At least we don't now. I have not seen one Democrat come forward with any indication whatsoever that even though they don't like parts of Obamacare, they're willing to repeal it and try something else.
And it would be vetoed anyway.
And even if they would, it would be vetoed by the president. And I know from direct contact with the White House, there's no way the president is going to do this. So if shutting down the government would force them to do this, and maybe doing it for a short amount of time, and we could achieve the goal, that deserves consideration. And some have proposed that. But they haven't been able to explain to me how we're going to get those votes from Democrats and how they're going to convince the president not to veto whatever we do if we did get those votes. So therefore, I've proposed what I think is a better tactic. People can disagree. The president has said he's going to delay the employer mandate because it's not working well with employers, among other things. Well, isn't it fair to delay everything since so much up in the air, particularly the individual mandate? And if we delay it 1 year and put it before the American people and say, let's have a referendum on this in the 2014 election, if you don't like Obamacare, send home the people who crafted it, Nancy Pelosi and Harry Reid, and give those who support it a majority so that they can use that leverage to get change. Ultimately, that may take till 2016 because the president has tenure until that particular point in time. But maybe an overwhelming enough referendum against this would cause the president to negotiate now with a Senate that would not be supporting what he's doing, but opposing what he's doing. So I'm proposing this delay, but I voted over 24 times to repeal. blocked every time by the Democrats in the Senate. And so I'm just saying, I think we need a better tactic to accomplish this goal.
Well, what makes you think, with all due respect, a delay would get through when a repeal didn't? I mean, I think the people who want to use the budget to attack it mm-hmm. think that this mm-hmm. may be the only leverage we have left, that we actually can influence yeah. the spending limit.
Well, the delay is not connected to the shutdown. Mm-hmm. And I think at a time when our economy is still fragile, still barely recovering from the deepest recession since the Depression, people out of work, college kids can't getting jobs, college graduates, high school graduates can't getting jobs. At a time like this, to throw a major curveball at the economy and unsettle and put more uncertainty in the economy, when you know it's not going to accomplish the goal, is the wrong thing to do. And so I think delay has a better chance than simply saying we're shutting down the government unless you defund. Secondly, Congressional Research Service, in response to requests from Senator Coburn, came back and said, you know, guess what? You can't shut down Obamacare by defunding it, because most of it is mandatory funded, and you don't have control over mandatory funding. In addition to that, all the taxes, I think there are 14 separate taxes, continue to go into effect on this. So even if you were able to get the votes to do it, you can't do it, according to the Congressional Research Service, because so much of it falls in the mandatory category, not in the discretionary category.
And painful experience shows that if government would shut down, more than likely the Republicans would take the political hit, correct?
Well, we have some experience with this, because that happened in 1995. Mm-hmm. And the president turned it on a dime, blamed Republicans, and after about 2 to 3 weeks of agony, all those who were saying, shut it down, shut it down, shut it down, were banging on the door saying, where's my check? Right. How come my son in the military is not getting his pay? How come everything I can't get through and get anything done in terms of my veterans benefit or whatever? Mm-hmm. Veterans rose up and said, hey, you promised us that, you know, medical care, and you promised us some pension, and we're not getting it.
Well, doesn't that get to the difficulty, though, of dealing with the budget? It's always easier for a politician to promise somebody something than it is take it away. Even if you don't have the money to give it, you know, you do it anyway. Right. So what's the magic bullet for the Republicans to take a bite out of the deficit? Because politically, Romney talked about repealing Obamacare. Clearly that didn't mm-hmm. work, now for a lot of reasons maybe. Mm-hmm. But Republicans have a much harder sell, it seems to me, than the Democrats do.
You know, I'm not sure I agree with you on that, because it's the Democrats who are supporting constituencies that depend on government funding for a number of things.
Well, that's kind of my point.
Well, and therefore, it's much harder, I think, for Democrats to undertake what I believe is necessary to put us on a path to fiscal responsibility, and that is a more limited government, a more efficient government along the lines of what we've done here in Indiana, and proven that it can be done. Tax reform, because it's so full of inequities.
Now, you've advocated that for a long time.
And I have advocated that for a long time. But the big one is the mandatory runaway, not under our control, mandatory spending.
Entitlements.
That has to be restructured, entitlements. The baby boom is retiring people at 10,000 a day. These programs were never designed to handle that kind of influx. And the options are either massive increase in taxes to cover the costs of what people are entitled under these programs to get, or restructuring, such as raising the retirement age, as we did with Social Security, but maybe matching that with Medicare over a period of time, which has great savings in the long term, doesn't affect anybody currently receiving it or about to receive it. Some modifications on the cost of living formula, which is out of balance right now, that saves some money. And some other restructuring, not to eliminate the programs, but to save the programs and keep us solvent. You get a lot of pushback from people saying, you're taking away my Social Security, you're taking away my Medicare. No, we're trying to save your Social Security. We're trying to save your Medicare. But it's going bust unless we do something.
But you know, as well as I do, you try that, there will be all kind of politicians, maybe one running against you, saying you're taking away their Medicare.
You know, the very first debate I had when I decided to run again, this question came up, and I said, folks, this is how I see the problem, if you vote for me, I'm going back, and my goal is, one of my major goals is going to be fixing the debt and deficit, or it's going to incorporate restructuring entitlements. If you don't want someone to carry that message, because I think they're going broke, but if you don't want someone, you should vote for my opponent. But if you do recognize that unless this is done, the whole thing's going to come down, I'd like you to vote for me. So I put in, I said, I don't want to be elected without that mandate to go and do that. And fortunately, I was elected, maybe for other reasons, I don't know. But I made it very clear to people that I'm not going to go back and say, okay, I got elected, and don't worry, I'm not going to touch a dime of anything. I won't do anything to cause you any heartburn in terms of what we might have to do long term to do these programs. So I feel like I have the freedom to go forward, and they of course have the freedom to throw me out if they don't like what I'm doing.
Do you ever worry though, and I know Governor Romney got into trouble for it in his campaign, but he essentially made note of what other people have said, that we're approaching, if not already there, the tipping point where more people are dependent on government than not.
Yeah, I have real concern about that, and I think that was a factor in the 2012 election. But you know, that's unsustainable, because in the end it comes crashing down because the government doesn't have the money. And right now we're running out of money.
It would be less painful to do it before it crashed, but getting people to vote what may not be in their own best short-term interest is a tough sell.
I had dinner with the head of the International Monetary Fund, Christine Lagarde, former finance minister of France. And we were talking about the deficit debt problems in Europe and how it was all kind of coming crashing down. And I asked her the question, I said, you know, the reforms that are being made now in Italy and Spain and Greece and these countries, tough reforms, would they have been made had there not been a crisis? And she said, oh heavens no, they wouldn't. She said, the revolver has to be to the temple of the politician with the trigger finger on the trigger before any politician is willing to say no.
But even then, they had people rioting in the streets over, I think, raising the retirement age to what, 65? And
there were riots. When I was in Berlin as ambassador, they had riots in the street because they have free college education, and they wanted to have a $50 charge to cover the cost of books. And there were riots in the street.
Yep. Well, let's talk just partisan politics for a minute.
Sure.
You mentioned the midterm election coming up next year. Clearly, the president wants to gain control of the entire Congress, the House and the Senate. Republicans would love to take back control of the Senate, obviously.
Would we ever?
What do you think needs to happen for the Republicans to succeed? And do you worry about the apparent division in the party, you know, the so-called moderates versus the Tea Party wing?
Yeah, I worry that we will, we're kind of a circular firing squad against each other, and that we will, you know, be our own worst enemies. And I hope we can sort all that out, because the goal really needs to be gaining control of the Senate if we're going to have any chance at all to really fulfill the desires and wishes of people that come to us and say, how come you can't do this or can't do that? Well, we don't have the votes to do it. We need to get the votes. So we're five short, six short, really, where the vice president could break the tie. And so, yes, I do worry about that. But I do think we have a real opportunity in 2014 for a couple reasons. One, this is now will be the completion of the sixth year of Obamacare, the sixth year of Obama's policies on the economy. And frankly, they're just disappointing in terms of whether you're for it, against it, ideologically like it or don't. They haven't worked, and people are out of work, and it's not getting better, and the economy's not getting much better. It's just growing way less than half of what it should. So more than half of what it should. So I think those will be issues in our favor, and I think that the kind of the illusion that this president has said, you know, I'm the way forward, people are going to start to say, I don't see any progress here.
Well, and traditionally the out party will pick up seats.
Traditionally, that's going for us also. There are a lot more Democrats up than Republicans because they had such a sweep in 2008. So all those things are going in our favor. But again, I think the only factor standing in the way is are our colleagues who want to attack Republicans for not being this or that or whatever, well, instead of going after the president and his policies.
Well, and in fact, you know, and I take no position on the Tea Party one way or the other, but I think even they would admit that some of their candidates weren't ready for prime time, and that maybe that cost the Republican Party at least two or three seats that maybe they would have won otherwise, including Indiana.
You know, it's important to understand that if you can get someone on our side that's, say, 95% with us, it's a lot better than having, and you don't like it, you don't vote for them because of the 5%, and they think, well, it's a lot better to have the other guy who's 100% against you. Let's go with the 95.
Well, the Republicans, and I like it about them up to a point, but they are more ideologically pure sometime and less willing to compromise. But
you have to win
first, right?
Well, that's right. Our party's based on principles, and I don't want to violate those principles. And those foundations, I think, the rock makes our party what it is. By the same token, you cannot achieve success unless you have a majority. And so, as I said, if you have to take somebody who maybe on an issue or two isn't there full time with you, better to have them on your side or her on your side than not, because the alternative is somebody working totally against you, and you have a much better chance to succeed over here than you do over there.
We only have maybe 2 or 3 minutes left. I did want to get to one issue that actually is bipartisan. You and Senator Donnelly, a Democrat, worked together on the Alicia Dawn Keel Respect for National Cemeteries Act, which essentially was to correct an error, a grave error, pardon the pun, of a guy who committed murder in Indianapolis. He happened to be an Army veteran and was buried in a national cemetery in Michigan, even contrary to existing regulations.
Right.
And the husband of the slain woman has family in Fort Wayne, so it had some local interest as well. You're trying to take care of that legislatively. Very quickly, talk about the bill and what has to happen for that to actually work.
Well, we worked like crazy together to get the VA to disinter the body and bury it in a private cemetery, but not the military cemetery, because it was a huge mistake. But we were not able to do that, and the law doesn't allow us to do that. So we are now working with the VA to pass a law, Senator Donnelly and I are together, that will give them the authority to do it. And this is this, you know, mix up of bureaucracy and laws and restrictions and regulations and everything else. And I wish we could have waived all that and just gotten this done, but no, we have to pass that through. I'm confident that we will. This is totally a nonpartisan issue. We're working together on it. Along with the VA and along with the family. And we want to be sensitive to the family's feelings, and I am sensitive. It's been an outrage that they've had to work this hard and press this much and trying to get the VA to come even to a decision. Mm-hmm. Finally, we forced them to make a decision, and the decision was, unfortunately, no, by law, we can't do it. We checked all the legalities.
They shouldn't have done what they did,
they can't undo it. So what we said is, okay, we will introduce a law on a bipartisan basis, Senator Donnelly and myself. We need you to work with us to get this through, and let's get this done in this next Congress.
Do you think, with everything else going on we've talked about, and you know, infinitely more, this will not be lost in the shuffle?
I won't let it get lost in the shuffle. I mean, sometimes these things boil down to personal issues that are very, very important. But it's also an important lesson for the VA to check this stuff out before and not let it happen again. But this family has suffered enough, and I think it deserves full attention, and I will not let something else interfere.
Well, I know they were especially aggravated that, you know, he got a hero's burial, essentially, at taxpayer expense.
Yeah.
And
a total blunder.
And the bills as well. But hats off to you and Senator Donnelly for, you know, we talk about the big stuff, but this is a good example of constituent service that politicians ought to do maybe more of. So
we work together carefully on that, and I have with Democrat Republicans colleagues. I have convened a process whereby both Democrat and Republicans representing Indiana in the Congress and in the Senate, I bring them together once a month in my office, coffee and donuts, and we talk about what can we work together for the good of Indiana. Okay. We have differences ideologically, but there are some things we can do together, and that's what we try to do.
Okay, well, Senator Dan Coats,
thank you
for joining us. And thank you for joining us. Make sure you check out this and other episodes of the Fort Report at www.news-sentinel.com. Thank you.
Good deal.